Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. This is the second video in a series about an affordable first telescope. It's sold as the Skywatcher Heritage 130 in the UK, and a very similar scope is sold as the AWB Onesky in the US. It costs around £140 or $200. In the first video, we unboxed the scope, and today we'll review how well it performs under the night sky from the perspective of a new astronomer. Okay, I've chosen to assess the scope against a series of criteria. So let's take a look. It's very easy to carry this 6 kilo scope around. You can store the scope unextended and then move it around to the best spot using this carrying handle. You can even move it during an observing session if your house or a tree is blocking your view. So here's my kit list. I've got the scope, I've got the eyepieces, I've got my phone with a SkyGuide app, and a red torch, and that's it. This scope is truly grab and go. It scores 10 out of 10 for portability. Now you can use this telescope with it sitting on a table, or you can use it with it on the ground. Now either way, you've got to position the scope so that you can look through the red dot finder and the eyepiece. So typically you're pointing the telescope whilst looking to point the tube using the red dot finder, and then when you think you're pointing in the right direction, you move to the eyepiece. Now this is fine, it just takes a little bit of practice. I find if the telescope's on the ground during the night, you've got to make sure you don't shove the telescope a little bit when you go between the red dot finder position and the eyepiece. But that's fine, it just takes a little bit of practice. Now the 25 eyepiece, that's to say the lower power eyepiece, I find it very comfortable to use. As someone who wears glasses, sometimes you can get eyepieces that you can't get to a position where you get a comfortable image. But it's not the case with this one. The 25 gives you a very comfortable field of view. The 10 millimeter focal length eyepiece, which gives a higher magnification of 65 with this scope, is slightly less comfortable, but that's typical. It's always the case that a lower power eyepiece is going to be slightly more comfortable to use. So in terms of comfort and ease of use, I'd say that this telescope scores 8 out of 10. One of the things that people new to astronomy worry about is whether they're going to be able to find objects with their telescope. Now for this money, you don't get a go-to database that points the telescopes at objects for you. So you'll have to learn some basic knowledge of the stars. Now that's okay, that's half the fun of astronomy. Besides that, I suggest you download a good sky app onto your phone, such as SkyGuide, and that will really help you to find your way around the night sky. Now in the first video we saw the red dot finder, and we saw that if it's lined up well with the telescope tube, and you only need to do that once, then it should help you to point the tube and the telescope accurately at a given place in the night sky. And I'd say that this red dot finder works very well. So if you've taken the time to make that alignment, then the object you're seeking should be within the field of view of the eyepiece, especially if you start using the lower power eyepiece, that's to say the one labeled 25. And just to illustrate that point, if we look here at the online website Astronomy Tools, you can type in the details of this 130mm telescope and you can see the relative field of view that you're going to get with a 25mm eyepiece here, that's the green circle, and then with the 10mm eyepiece, that's the purple circle. So this just shows you that when you're first looking for an object, it's going to be much easier to use that lower power eyepiece because it just gives you a much bigger field of view. So overall, if you follow this advice for using the right eyepiece and for lining up the red dot finder, I'll give this telescope 7 out of 10 for object location. So what sort of views can you get? Well, a couple of words of warning to start with. If you're new to astronomy, it's important to recognise that the views you'll see through a $200 scope will not be as good as the images from the Hubble Space Telescope. Many faint and fuzzy objects like galaxies and nebulae are still faint and fuzzy even in a $2,000 scope. It is a big universe after all. Secondly, any telescope should be well collimated. The optics should be in good mechanical alignment with each other in order to get the best performance. The good news is that if you remember these 2 points, there are many, many objects in the night sky that look amazing with a telescope of this size. Now, I've looked at a range of these to give you some impression of what you might be able to see with this 130mm telescope. So looking at the constellation of Orion, over here on the left, there's an image I took with a 50mm lens on a digital SLR. And you can see it's quite a well-known constellation during the winter, and the three stars of the belt are here in the middle. Now underneath, with your naked eye, it's not quite as obvious as it shows in this picture here, but with your naked eye you can see something fuzzy in this area here, which is called Orion's Sword. Now if we zoom in a little bit, we can get a slightly clearer view of that part of the constellation, and there we go. And this is what's known as the Orion Nebula, Messier 42. It's one of the brightest deep sky objects that you can see. Now, over here on the right, what I've done here is I've just placed my smartphone over the eyepiece of the Heritage 130, and I've just taken a very quick shot. But the idea here is to give you an idea of the field of view. This is with a 25mm eyepiece, and it also shows you that you will be able to detect with this telescope, you'll be able to detect some of the nebulosity, the fuzziness, if you like, of this nebula. It'll look a little bit better than this, but hopefully it gives you some idea of the sort of field of view you'll get with this telescope. Okay, so moving on to another object. Here on the left, there's another wide field view of the winter sky, and down here is the constellation of Orion that we just looked at with the Orion Nebula just visible there. Now, if we move further north, we come to the constellation of Taurus, and within Taurus, there's a very famous star cluster called the Seven Sisters, and it's just here. And I can zoom in a little bit so we get an idea of what it looks like. Now, it's very bright, obvious to the naked eye, high up in the sky at this time of year, in the winter, and what I've done again is just show you roughly what you might see with the Heritage 130 here on the right. So again, single shot over the eyepiece using a smartphone gives you an idea that you can fit this star cluster into the field of view of the telescope, and with your eye you'll see far more stars like this. The view will be better than this image portrays, but it gives you an idea. And if we zoom back out again on the left, so you can imagine yourself looking up at the night sky, and this is the sort of field of view that you're looking at with the lower power eyepiece of the Heritage telescope. And now the moon, obviously going to be one of your first targets when you get a new telescope, and this is again another quick shot over an eyepiece, the 25mm eyepiece. And if we zoom in, we can see, I think, some idea of the quality of the optics of this telescope. So I've not modified this picture in any way. This is showing you, I'd say, a very clear view of some of the craters along the terminator here, which is the region between the light and the dark, and really nice detail. You could obviously play around, adjust the exposure, perhaps get a slightly clearer view of some of the other features, but very pleased with this. This is really excellent quality and shows you why the moon and the bright planets are going to be really good targets for this telescope. So taking all that on board, I'd say that this 130mm telescope, the overall image quality is very good. I'm going to give it 8 out of 10. So what could be better? Well, I've only got a couple of minor gripes. The open tube design of a flex tube telescope like this can mean that stray light can disrupt your view. You should always position any scope away from distracting street lights, but stray light can still reach the mirrors through this gap. Now, many people solve this issue using a light shroud. It can be a plastic tube or a piece of fabric that you wrap around the tube. It's a small problem that's easily solved. Secondly, the 10mm eyepiece is only really okay. It's pretty basic fare, and it's not a surprise because the telescope for this budget is a pretty good package, and probably this is one of the weaker links. But that's okay. Again, you can always upgrade your eyepieces as your interest in astronomy grows. As with all reflectors, sooner or later you'll need to master collimation, which I've mentioned on a couple of occasions, but it's not a big issue. And certainly with this telescope, it's relatively straightforward to collimate, and the instructions are in the manual. Now, this particular one was in quite good collimation when I received it, so I've only had to do a minor adjustment. So what's my conclusion? Well, I like this scope a lot. It reminds me how great it is to be able to get out under the stars within 5 minutes, and I thoroughly recommend it to someone who's new to astronomy, who's looking to buy themselves or a friend or family member a first telescope. For £140 or $200, I think it is fantastic value, and I score it 9 out of 10 overall. So I hope this video has been useful. If you'd like to see further videos of this telescope and other astronomy videos, please press the red subscribe button and subscribe to Jenham's Astro. Thanks for watching.